We're rolling.
We're rolling. Dana Eagle.
Yeah.
I just want you to, you said a quarter fell out onto the rug. Gary Stockdale, my daughter has perfect pitch.
Oh.
And her name is Hannah Feldman. And I can take a dime, a penny, and a quarter and drop it on a table. And by the sound that it makes, she can tell me, Hannah Feldman can tell me if it's a dime, a quarter, a nickel, or a penny.
Fabulous.
Is she Jewish?
When I said Hannah Feldman, I said that is the most attractive and unattractive trait in a human being that you can imagine. It's kind of freakish.
She's a savant.
She's
my change.
No, it's Sephardic, actually.
Guy Nicolucci is with us, Steve Rosenfield, and Steve Skrovan. This is a writer's roundtable. We originally were planning to have Meryl Marco here with us.
We weren't big enough for her.
Well, I'm a pig, and we did an hour together. Her book is amazing. I cannot recommend it enough. And we started talking about writing for television, and I wanted to bring you guys in, but her take on it was just so great.
So she's actually written for television. So
well, no, you know, it's just a different experience. And then to turn it into a round table, it was going to be diluted. And Gary Stockdale is going to sing a song for us very quickly. June Foray can come in next week. She's the voice of Natasha, Tweety Bird's mother.
Wow.
Rocky. And we also have Lorraine Newman. What do you think? That's a good show, right?
It's a good show.
That is a good show.
Better than this show.
Why aren't we doing that show now?
Exactly. Yeah. Let's go home.
Well, that's what I was trying to tell the audience.
Are we doing a teaser for next week?
This one you may not be enjoying, but next week, yeah, have we got a show for you. So what should we do? That would be a fun thing to do. We'll think about.
How are we going to write for Tweety Bird?
Now, Will Ryan from the Cactus County Cowboys, you say that legally we're allowed to have her do sketches using the
parody.
It's parody.
Fair use.
It is fair use. Yeah.
Parody. Mm-hmm.
But she might have a contract with, say, Warner Brothers, where she can only do that voice for them. Right?
You might want to ask her before she comes.
I don't believe you can copyright a voice. You can copyright a song or a piece of written material, but
I think those voices must be copywritten.
I would
Tweety
think
Bird
so.
And all those are Warner Brothers.
Yeah, I can't imagine.
If you were to say, here, we're going to do a show about Tweety Bird, I think they could get you. If you're going to do the voice of Tweety Bird, I don't think they can do anything.
Oh, you don't identify it as Tweety Bird.
But then it's satire, right?
What? Remember we did a sketch with that ended with Porky Pig saying, that's all. We just didn't call him Porky Pig.
Right.
We just said, oh, here's the pig.
I just want to say, June is fond of quoting Bill Scott, who was the co-executive producer of Rocky and Bullwinkle and the head writer and the voice of Bullwinkle. And he said, June, remember, someone else may own the characters, but you own your own voices. You own your voices.
Wow, okay. Now, what did Jay Ward say? Because he was the real owner.
He was in the hospital.
There's one other little rule on it, too.
Yes?
They will come after you if the thing you're doing is making any money.
Ah, well, we won't have to worry.
We're safe. We'll be safe for years to come.
We've outfoxed them.
Or how about good?
We don't have anything they want.
I'll call her tomorrow.
Okay, well, yeah, we'll talk. That's good. Shows, we're getting interesting shows. Great writing, great performers. Steve Skrovan is not only a fantastic comedy writer, but the director of An Unreasonable Man.
That's correct.
That's right. Dana Eagle, he directed the documentary about Ralph Nader, which is a great documentary, and Henriette Mantel.
That's correct.
And she's going to get Ralph to come do the show, and hopefully some sketches with us. He's a funny guy.
I saw him at SNL, remember?
That's right.
He did Saturday Night Live, yeah. But the airbag didn't deploy. That was the thing.
That's right.
They equipped him with an airbag, and it was supposed to deploy when Lorraine Newman hugged him. You can ask her about that.
Hmm.
About doing a sketch with Ralph Nader.
I can't imagine my airbag not deploying if Lorraine hugged me.
I can't imagine my airbag not deploying.
Well, the words can mean two different things. Is this what you guys are going for?
You're also one of the chairmen of the boards or What are you?
I'm Frank Sinatra.
You're the chair. you're on the board.
I'm on the board of Public Citizen, which is the group that Ralph started in 1971 and then hasn't been involved with formally for 30 years. But in doing the movie, I met a lot of these people. I met Sid Wolfe and Joan Claybrook and Rob Weissman, who's now the current president, and interviewed them. And that's my punishment for doing the movie was to be asked to be on the board. And so that's what I've been doing. I've been on the board for about 5 years now, and I've been trying to help them raise money and do their work.
And you introduced me to Barbara Ehrenreich.
I introduced you to your hero, Barbara Ehrenreich, who is also on the board. Yep. And
great book.
At the benefit, Stand Up for Main Street in June. And we're doing another one of those in April.
With me?
And you are going to be my co-host.
Is Jimmy Dore going to be there?
Jimmy Dore could be here. I haven't talked to him yet. But, yeah, if we can figure out three, yeah, we could do three hosts.
Speaking of Jimmy Dore, Steve Rosenfield, you're on the Jimmy Dore show all
I'm
the
on
time.
The show every other
how's
week.
That, how's that working
they,
out
They rotate
you?
Me out, me and Robert Yesimura. Yeah, it's been fun. I'm writing for him and performing on his monthly shows that he does at Flappers.
But this is more fun. Just say yes.
Yes.
You get treated better here.
I like them in different ways, you know. It's hard to compare apples and but I'm apples funnier. And lousy shows. It's hard to compare.
You have a good personality.
But he's prettier and sexier.
Yes.
Okay. And Guy Nicolucci.
Hello, sir.
Comedy writer extraordinaire.
Well, half right.
You have to talk closer to the microphone.
Half right.
You've written for Conan and Jon Stewart. And
among other sins.
And the roasts. You're a great comedy writer. So let's talk about comedy writing.
All right.
But maybe Gary Stockdale wants to sing a song first.
Up to you, David.
Why don't we get rolling on how great it is to be a comedy writer, and then we'll stop and have a song. And then Meryl Marco, who is a novelist and writes essays and pieces, and she has a great book out, a collection of her essays. You know, there's a lot. We'll cut this.
Cool, Calm, and Contentious is the name of the book.
Cool, Calm, and Contentious.
Yes. Is that what you were looking for?
Yes. Thank you.
Steve did not check
you
the Kindle.
You should have just asked.
But had the name.
Cool, Calm, and Contentious. I'm reading it, and it's really a great read. Have you picked it up yet?
I have not.
It's great.
But I sort of seen her interviewed and talked about it, so it sounds good.
Meryl worked in television. She worked for the created the Letterman Show, worked with Michael Moore and sitcoms and stuff like that. And she describes the writing room in the interview I did with her. Everybody comes to work in a state of rage because they're all pitching to one guy, and it's
like baby birds in the nest looking for the worm. Everybody's chirping, and you've got to get on the same frequency as the showrunner. So you sort of that's my metaphor. And then you know, if you get a joke and you get a worm.
Mm-hmm. But I don't come in a state of rage. I leave in a state of rage.
I leave in a state of rejection and dejection.
I'm usually fired in a state of rage. So that's what happens.
And New York.
It doesn't make sense. The system for writing for television now does not make sense.
What about the system?
It's an old model. It's the old Sid Caesar model where I'm the alpha male, I'm going to sit at the head of the table, and I'm going to kill your babies. You're going to put babies in front of me, and I'm going to kill 99.9% of them, and that will make me feel better about myself because I can't get it up for my wife. And at the time...
Who do you mean specifically?
Whose wife?
Yes.
And at the time, I think in the 50s, when there were three networks... You could afford to have a writing staff sitting around wasting their time and wasting their efforts. I think it's the 21st century. The idea now of having all these highly paid writers spending 15 hours in a room getting their ideas destroyed because some guy is either too young to figure out what's funny or too old to get it up for his wife and wants to punish these comedy writers by making them feel like lesser men. It just doesn't make any sense to me.
Who have you worked for? Because...
he started on the Arthur Godfrey Hour.
Well, yeah, because I've been lucky. on some, not on all the shows I've worked on, but some of them, you know, that.
Well, you worked. You had the Everybody Loves Raymond job. You worked for Phil Rosenfield.
Yes,
and that's like the. That's
but you
the,
still you still get your ideas rejected, because there have to be decisions made. But I have not the level of vitriol. You know, the
he's
reason,
the heroin dealer. Phil Rosenthal is the guy you meet. And he gets you hooked to the comedy writing because he's a nice guy, and you think, oh, all comedy rooms must.
No,
be
but
great.
But he's still rejecting you. You're not talking about. You're talking about the manner of the rejection. It's going to be 99% rejection no matter what, because you have 10 people in a room pitching lines, and you can only use one of them.
Right.
So there's going to be rejection. What you're describing is something. Even the last show that I was on, which I got off of. And it wasn't actually a alpha male. It was an alpha female. And she was very nice about rejecting, but it was still a rejection. So I have not encountered so much the angry, I'm going to reject you because I have a small penis thing.
Maybe you're a good writer. Maybe you don't have to look for excuses like some of us have.
But I am a little bit more well adjusted than the average writer. Yes.
Maybe you're good. Maybe you have talent. Maybe some of us get in over our heads and can't
I'm
handle the pressure and need to find an excuse.
I'm not sure about the talent, but I will claim I'm pretty well adjusted.
Well, my thing is, and it is all rejection, but you know, the actual writing is the fun part. You know, to actually create something that makes you in your head you titter and go, "Aha, I'm funny." And I think I stole this idea from Jack Lemmon, who says they don't pay me to act. They pay me to sit around and wait and deal with all the BS and the acting I do for free. And the way I look at it, they're paying me to listen to their BS mm-hmm. and hang around. And I'm writing the jokes for me.
Right.
Yes, that when you have to share it with something or somebody or the world, that's when it, you know, it's all perfect in your head and everybody's laughing at the same time and it's great. And that's the best time when you've got it, when say, you know, if you're writing a script and you're off on the script and it's all yours and everybody's put their input in, but now you have to form it. That's the most fun part. And then you have to bring it back into the room and get it ripped to shreds, whether it's ripped to shreds in a nice way, in a kind way, or ripped to shreds in a more vitriolic way. It's still ripped to shreds, and you've got to be able to handle that.
Everybody Loves Raymond is the gold standard of sitcoms. So I'm not going to ask you about that.
Okay.
Because that makes me feel less than. I don't need to hear about your success on a,
none of us do.
On a profitable Emmy Award-winning show.
Now syndicated in Europe.
Yes.
You can walk into any
room.
You
don't want to hear about the fact I could buy each and every one of you?
No.
Have you killed legally?
Brings no joy to me.
Okay.
But let's say you're on a lousy sitcom.
Yes, okay.
Okay. I won't ask you for any names.
I have been.
Okay. And you were unhappy there.
Yeah.
And you were underpaid and underappreciated, and you felt lousy, right?
Now I feel don't better. Know about the underpaid part, but...
Okay. Just make me... Let me feel good about myself.
Give him something.
Give me something.
I'm not going to... You know, I haven't chosen what I'm going to give him
okay,
yet.
So when you're on a lousy television show...
Yes.
You hand in a first draft.
Yes.
And then the network says, change it.
Network doesn't say it at that point. Your first draft, network doesn't... If I'm writing a pilot, that'll... That
okay,
might
so, but you're on four guys in the pair of teeth.
Four guys in the pair, yes.
For the country channel. So four guys sharing two teeth. Pitch this.
Well, first of all, yeah, I got to make a note of that one.
Make the teeth likable.
Let me ask my question.
Okay.
You were going
to
say something?
I was going to say, you don't hand a first draft to the network.
Right. Okay. So you're on staff.
Yeah.
They assign a script to you.
Yes.
The head writer.
Yes.
You spend a week writing the greatest script, greatest first draft.
Yes, in my head.
In your head. But the head writer has to justify his paycheck and the writing staff. So it gets rewritten and rewritten, and then it gets passed through the sieve of the actors and the executives. And by the time it gets on the air, everybody's been fixing the script.
Yes.
What do you think would be better if they just took your first draft and maybe punched up a couple of jokes or let it go through the sausage-making factory?
Well, I mean, it all depends on the script.
The answer is if they left your script alone.
The answer is, well, that's not the answer.
That's the, you don't know what you're talking about.
No, it is not the answer. It is not the, although, you know, there was a term that we used on one show when sometimes you'd go back to the head writer would say, well, what was in the original draft there, this line? And that was called the writer's superior script. What was in the writer's superior? So that happens. And you have to understand, here's the thing. You are there to serve this the showrunner. And so everything ultimately is their vision because it's their responsibility. So you are, it's not your piece of writing. You are sublimating your own vision for the vision of the showrunner, and how well you're able to do that,
right,
it determines how long you will thrive.
Right.
So you can't go in with the same sense of ownership.
Right.
If you're not the showrunner, or if it's not, you know, I can see if you're writing a sketch and you're, you know, it's your own thing and it doesn't go through the sausage machine or it does and whatever, but you have more sense of ownership. I've had scripts on the air where where other people have had more lines than I have ultimately, and vice versa, where I've had more lines in somebody else's script than they did, but their name is on it. When you're doing 20, 22 episodes a year, you have these big writing staffs because that's a lot of material to produce in a year. And so you have to have these big writing staffs. And I don't the people that I've worked with, the showrunners, have been varying talents, but I haven't encountered that they're doing it because they need to prove that they are better than you and all of that. It's either they can be different levels of competence.
I think you're answering this question to prove that you're better than I am.
He doesn't need to
be better.
Maybe I filter everything through everybody trying to prove they're better than
I
am.
I'm
a very sick man.
Well, we agree with that. But
that is a distinct possibility.
But I've only had...
I don't like your tone of voice. You're trying to prove right now that you can get it up for my wife.
No man can do... No. Wow, you better cut this out. It will never make me any more ZD. But I've only had one equivalent showrunner who was a guy who had absolutely no talent, a miserable, nasty human being who did bring the penis factor into this. I've had that once. Wow, he can read minds.
We'll bleep that.
Thank you.
I thought that would get a laugh.
Yeah, well, it did for me. And fear. But... that is the only time. I mean, an actively untalented human being brings that to the table. I've been fortunate. I've only had that once in my career.
Right. Right.
Don't get me wrong, David. It hurts. Every time you're sitting there and they're going through the script, your script, and it's like, oh, do you see what I have here? Did anybody bother to read this? Or, if you change that, you don't understand. 3 pages later, that's going to screw that. Right. And you say goodbye to the bit you know is going to have to go 3 pages later because they just killed the setup.
Steve, can I interrupt? Because I just actually was in a bar last night and heard a good story about a guy who worked on the Sinbad sitcom.
Yeah.
And he says, we'd go down to rehearsal, and Sinbad would say, hey, guys, put away your scripts. We've thought of something delicious, much better than what you wrote.
Oh, you know, Sinbad is a compound word where each element describes the comedy.
Sin worse.
But the guy I was talking to said, and it was like, and Sinbad would have come up with some quip that basically gave away a plot point that he wouldn't have known from 3 pages later.
Right.
And you had to explain to him that and he didn't listen, so you had to run up and rewrite the script.
Well, I've had that experience with actors where they, you know, they just don't have the head. The actors are paid to be a tree. They're not paid to see the forest. And so you have to explain to them when they want to get involved. And it's rare, but there are those people. But they just don't have the head for that, so they don't understand that if you pull this string, then this affects everything, and it's they don't see that. They just see blah, 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 my line, blah, 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 my line.
Why were sitcoms written by two guys in the 60s?
Who were those two guys?
They
Carl Reiner and somebody else. Wrote
the, Jerry Belson and Gary Marshall wrote The Odd Couple, basically, right?
Yeah, they didn't need like 26 guys. I think it's great that they're hiring all these people. I just wonder about the...
You know, I don't know the facts of that. I know Larry Gelbart wrote a lot of the MASHes alone. But I don't know. Somehow their production schedule allowed that. You know, Aaron Sorkin tried to write everything himself. Larry David tried to write everything himself. But he still needed people to feed him ideas and
I think the Gary Marshalls would buy freelance ideas. You know, I don't know. I don't think they generated all the ideas themselves, and they may have been rewriting. And I don't know. I don't think they only did it themselves.
I would have to get some verification on that too, because it's an enormous job, and just generating the ideas, like you say, writing the scripts in certain ways is easier when you know your show and you know your characters and the voices. But getting the ideas that work and have good beginning, middle, and end, that's the hard part.
Well, the classic story about you, I was watching.
There's a classic story about
you? Yes.
I didn't know that either.
Steve, will you shut up, please? You're really dominating the entire panel here, okay?
I was watching.
I'm fascinated with all you idiots.
Boy, I don't know which Steve I hate more.
I was watching.
You're all filled with hate.
I was watching the PBS, and there's a special about primetime legends, and obviously, everybody loves Raymond, is included in it.
Yes, everyone loves Raymond, is, but not me.
And they tell the story about they were out of ideas.
Oh, the story, Phil, I think, was probably telling the story about all of our ideas on that show came from real life. It came from some conflict or some event that happened, and then we would fit it into the show and expand on it or whatever. And, my joke about that is our wives and spouses got used to things being used of their lives. And so I'd be in an argument with my wife, and she would see my eyes sort of go into the corner of the room in the middle of the argument. And she'd go, "This is not for the show. This is not for the show." And then I explained to her how much they'd pay for each episode. And she'd go, "Okay, this is for the show." And sometimes we'd extend the argument artificially just to get a second act. So, yeah. That, and actually, there's even a funnier story that Lou Schneider tells where this is later in the run of the show. And
excuse me for one second, but that is a true story. That is absolutely true, that you and your wife fought to extend it to the second act.
Yeah, well, in a manner of speaking.
I can see how that,
you know,
absolutely.
When your wife
that becomes
starts
improv.
Pitching on the argument, you know she's trained well now, because she sees the pot of gold.
Because fighting is acting. When you're fighting with your wife, it is like an improv exercise. So I can see.
It's always the same script with me.
I'm still waiting for the happy ending.
I always the first
usually
rule,
I'm wrong.
No, the first rule of improv is the same rule of fighting with my wife. Always say yes. So.
And that's what pisses her off, because she knows you're patronizing her. But Lou tells the story. Now, this is later in the run
now,
of the
you
series.
Had a great writing role. Like Lou Schneider.
Lou
Schneider
is very funny. So do I.
And he should come by.
I'll bring him by.
He's
in the Palisades, so I don't know if he's ever been.
But he's a great guy. And that writing room was a fun writing room.
You know what? If you want to do a show sometime, I'll bring who's ever around, and we'll tell stories like we did. We used to do a show. We used to do a theater show.
And I hated the fact that you guys were so happy and successful.
Yes.
And so that would be called Let's Torture David Feldman.
I'm all for
it. Look how happy we were on a successful sitcom.
Yes. But can I tell the story about
Go ahead. Is it going to make me miserable?
No. It'll make you laugh.
Okay.
By now, but season six, the wives are hip to the whole, if something goes wrong, it could be a story. So there's always a silver lining. And he's on a vacation with his family, and it's a ski vacation. And they're coming back from their day of skiing, and they're going up in the elevator with all their equipment. And Lou drops his keys, and it falls into the crack in the elevator floor, and his wife is holding the door as it keeps trying to shut while he's trying to fish the keys out of the crack, and he can't get them out, and he's cursing. And his wife, who's hip to now, okay, bad things can be stories, says to Lou, "Well, think of it this way, Lou, could be an episode. And Lou goes, no, no. Ray already lost his wedding ring down a grate. We already did that show. This is just some shitty that happened. That's like the Mel Brooks sketch when Mel Brooks, where he's walking down the street, two nuns pass, Carmen, and he says the two nuns, we just cut that sketch.
Which you worked on Conan for all those years.
Many years.
And in the same building as Mel Brooks, where they did your show of shows. And I always, whenever I did stand up on Conan, I always thought of that joke because you'd go do Conan and there would be nuns walking around or there'd be Napoleon walking around.
Pumas and
so
costumes.
You, and then you go out into the street and everybody looks like they're in some sketch.
Yeah.
Yeah. I used to work at the Paramount.
The whole subtext of that story was that I used to do stand-up on Conan. Go ahead.
Very talented man, David.
Thank you.
How's he taking it?
Finish that thought.
I used to work at, did a show at Paramount, and they do the Star
Trek. Ow. Go ahead.
They do the Star
Trek.
It's always about you, isn't it?
They do. Paramount?
You've opened stigmata on David's hands.
Yeah, really?
How did you do that?
Everybody loves Raymond and Paramount in the same conversation.
Oh, but that show lasted 20 episodes.
Ah, okay.
So, feeling better now? And they do the Star Trek episodes there. And so you'd be walking by to lunch, and there'd be a Klingon on a folding chair reading Variety.
In Klingon or English?
I think it was the Klingon version, but he was smoking a cigarette.
And I can see how people – that's why it's so dangerous, because if you're in your 20s – and you see that, you decide, this is all I ever want to experience for the rest of my life. I'll do whatever it takes to just be on this lot so I can see that. Because it's intoxicating.
Yeah.
But it's dangerous because it's not real and it's not family and it's not friends. It's a factory. And you get sucked into it emotionally.
I wish.
And you think, this is, I will give up, and so I will give up everything. I will give up my family, my morals, just so I can be part of this.
I don't think I know you anymore. You bitter, immoral.
I've seen your family, Dave. Not much of a trade. Just putting that out there.
I sold my soul. This is what I ended up with.
So we're actually in hell. This is what hell is?
This is it
it's a radio show, the podcast that never ends.
Turns out the blue book value on my soul is the equivalent of 64 Ramblings.
Did you get change for a dollar is my question.
Yes.
It is fun writing for television.
You worked on what show?
My first job in television was Roseanne.
Okay.
But there's
stories about Roseanne where that was a factory, so I can see where your bitterness comes from.
And then I went to Dennis Miller.
Again, okay, yeah. You're
sweet man.
Yeah.
And then a couple of, I did 10 years with Dennis, 5 years with Bill Maher.
That's, you've hit the trifecta.
And then I went to Jon Stewart, who turned out to be worse than Dennis and Bill Maher combined.
You know what? I'm
not going to edit this before you respond to that.
Jon was a friend of mine.
I love Jon Stewart. He is a great human being.
I've not heard these stories about him.
But you've heard the rumor. You've heard people talk.
I've heard some guys talk. Yes.
Yeah. He's not good to his writers.
That's. I'm very disappointed to hear that.
And Dana Eagle said something. You said something interesting last night about why you think a lot of these stand-up comics who hire writers are bad to their.
Well, I have a friend that came up because I have a friend that ghostwrites on films, and it never occurred to me before that all these guys that churn out films, year after year. Of course, they can't do that on their own, and so things get kind of tight between them. And
so Woody Allen's got a ghostwriter.
I don't know about Woody
Allen. Marshall Bergman.
and so I guess I just, and I have lots of friends that write on these kinds of shows who are just as angry as
And why is that?
Because I think there's a certain amount of shame for the host who's the comedian and, getting all the accolades and their name is even though there's a list of writers, it's still them that's getting the credit. And so there's kind of a lot of shame associated with, I just got this huge laugh. They feel like a fraud. They feel like a fraud.
Right.
Well, that there's a logic to that.
And they would rather use weaker material than use great material.
Except, again, I've worked with Ray Romano, one of the most decent people on the planet, and shares credit, gives... Jerry Seinfeld is the same way. Let other people have funny lines mm-hmm. because they're smart enough to know
right.
that they don't have to do all the heavy lifting if they surround themselves by good people.
Right.
And in the beginning, it was hard for Ray to kind of... have other people write for him because you come up as a stand-up and you spend all this time developing your own persona and your own voice, and then a bunch of people you've never met are going to start writing for you. That's an odd thing. And so the first year or so, he, you know, it was tough for him to adjust to that. But once, you know, you spend enough time together and you kind of get in sync, there couldn't have been a more generous guy. I mean, he still gave us a hard time about the writing, about the but it was never personal. It was always about the product
right.
and you know, let's make it good. And I wouldn't say this way. He actually said one thing that made us all laugh. I think it was the second season where somebody written in a script that Ray drinks a cup of coffee. Now, Ray's not a coffee drinker, but his whole act is based on personal stuff that he really does. And he's like, but I don't drink coffee. I never drink, you know. And
it Phil's, looks like he's wired all the time.
And Phil's saying, you know, but, you know, for this bit, let's just say, you know, you drink coffee, you know, and we, for half hour, we're talking about whether he should do this bit because he has to drink coffee. And finally, he just relented and gave in. He goes, all right, I guess eventually I knew I was going to have to act.
Right.
That's where Sinbad is different. He never gave in and learned to act.
Well, and that's why Sinbad is not still getting checks.
Let's have Mr. Gary Stockdale, who's with us. Your new CD is out. What is the name of your
CD? It's called Sure of Myself, which for baby boomers is spelled like Thank You for Letting Me Be Myself, which was, I should take the hat off first.
Thank you.
I had that 45.
It's a great 12.
Sly and Family
Sly's
Stone?
Living in a trailer now.
Like, is he really?
Oh, yeah, on the street. They just did an article about him, like many comedy writers, I think.
Wow.
Sly from and the Family Stone?
Is, yeah, Sylvester
Stone.
Is living in a trailer?
Living in an RV, in an RV that was given to him, donated to him, and he just is on the street.
What happened to the royalties and all
up
that
up his
stuff?
Nose, I think.
Well, a lot of drugs, a lot of selling them to get drugs, a lot of craziness and insanity. And for most people, showbiz is totally smooth sailing. But he had his own problems, too.
Yeah, but why can't Steve Skrovan have told me stories like that?
are we in a pledge drive right now? Are we raising money for Sly Stone?
Steve showed up on time to every gig. You never knew whether Sly was going to show
you
up.
You come in, you have a song, you have a wonderful story, a heartwarming Christmas tale about Sly from living in an RV and being broke. Something I'm going to drive home and I'll be purring and feeling good about it. Steve Skrovan comes in. Oh, we all loved each other on Raymond, and Phil Rosenfall is the greatest showrunner in the world.
We encountered this too. There's a comic, a very funny guy named Dave Flabot, and there was an article that came out in the Writers Guild magazine called Written By.
Somebody reads that?
this guy read it, and it was one of those articles about it, and it was same complaint. About how everybody loves each other and they don't have dinner. And Dave Flabot says, Lou Schneider calls him up, and Dave Flabot, it's Lou Schneider from Everybody Loves Raymond, where all the desks are made of chocolate.
That show, we're the brother. All the other comedy writers feel like the brother, and Everybody Loves Raymond.
That's right. That's right.
That's what you've done to us.
Did you ever see the video Mike Rowe made for Phil Rosenthal's birthday like 10 years ago?
At the roast, yeah.
Right, in which elves came in. You guys all left at 6, and elves came in and wrote all night.
That's right.
And they wanted co-writing credit.
Yes.
Oh, that's a great joke.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
You know that joke.
I'm not going to tell it around a room of comedy writers.
That's a great joke. Do you know that joke?
I don't think I do.
No. You know that joke?
Tell the joke.
Sing your song. We'll end
every
with that
comedy
joke.
Writer who's a friend of mine will go, Stockdale's going to tell a joke. Stop him. The one thing that this feeds into is as comedy writers, you have to collaborate. And so this is a song about collaboration.
I'm sorry.
That's all right. Please.
You are a terrible host.
You blew it.
No, because I'm sorry, because you're talking about my mother was French. So during World War II, she turned in a lot of Jewish. Is that what you're talking about?
There'll be a short quizzling later.
Because that's what they told me. When I was told that comedy writing was about collaboration, having the background that I have, where my mother was a French who turned in all these
everybody
Jews during World War II.
Everyone loves Vichy.
That's right. Yeah.
Everyone loves Patin.
So I showed up in my first writing gig and just started turning in all the Jewish writers because they said it was about collaboration. Apparently I was wrong.
I can't understand why anybody would rewrite you.
There's another kind of writer than a Jewish writer?
That's a myth. They're all Irish Catholic.
That's two Italians at the table. I think.
Are you Italian?
Half Italian, yeah.
And what's the other half?
Czechoslovakian.
I'm sorry.
Which means that you...
Every December 7th, I...
Václav Havel.
He's half Italian and half Czechoslovakian. This means that there is no good punchline for that.
You're half Italian.
Every September 1st, I invade the Sudetenland and surrender. I don't know what that
is. He's a chop.
It's a canceled, it's a canceled Czech joke.
Yes.
Hi, David.
Let Gary do his song.
No,
started
please. This is great.
The first he was doing...
It becomes richer.
I heard the first three chords of Stairway to Heaven.
All right, well, hang on. His wife, he's part Czechoslovakian.
Which doesn't exist anymore. So
no, it did when I was born. Mm-hmm. No, actually, literally, my grandmother was Czech and my grandfather was Slovak. So Skrovan is actually Slovak. And probably in the old country, it was called Skrovan.
Hang on.
And so Private Eddie Slovak was the last American executed for desertion?
Yes.
Just putting that
out. Come on. He's part Czech and he's part Italian.
You got something for this?
No.
This is the hardest.
Let me see. He's still
Did. He invades the Sudetenland and then surrenders.
There is a surrender. He doesn't know who to surrender to? I don't know.
Yeah, something. Half Czech.
Oh, I know.
Half Italian, yeah.
Hates Jews.
Yeah, but what's the joke part? Yeah, that's true, but you were going to say a joke.
That was the joke.
Oh. I thought you were just stating a fact.
Oh, wait a second. The Z is silent like omerta. We're Czech. I'm working here.
Gary, will you please do the song?
Gears going in that with the smoke.
Gary, please start playing your instrument.
No, we got a problem here.
What? What's the problem?
We got world-class comedy writers in this room, and you're part Czech and part Italian.
And there's no joke.
And there's no joke.
I have a friend who's half Japanese and half black. Every December 7th, he attacks Pearl Bailey.
I have a friend who's half Japanese and has a severe astigmatism. Every December 7th, he attacks Pearl Vision.
What is the stereotype about Czechs?
I don't think there was one. And I'll tell you a short story about when I was in high school. I went to this Catholic prep school where they did hazing. And the seniors would haze the freshmen. And one time I was like, hey, what are you laughing at, Scott?
He's thinking of Texas A&M.
So they put all the seniors in a little theater, and all the freshmen had to go up on stage, and the seniors would just say, "What's your name?" And then they'd mock their name. "What's your nationality?" And they'd mock the nationality, and, you know, poor guys were Italian. They had, Guinea, this. Guys were Irish. They had this. Black, they had this. And I had a senior. Everybody was assigned a senior, and this guy was a nice guy. And he says, before I go up to take this abuse, he goes, what's your nationality? And I went, well, I'm half Italian and half Czechoslovakian. And he thinks for a second, goes, say Czechoslovakian. Because he knew the mooks wouldn't have anything for that. If I said Italian, they'd have all the Italian stuff. But Czechoslovakian, they'd come over.
Yeah, what? There is no.
Well, it's a made-up country. I mean, it was like three different countries that they put together at the end of World War One. You know, Slovenia, the Czech Republic, and Slovakia.
Well, it was all part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. Yeah. It's Bohemia. Right. It's
the food is great. It's a mix of German, Italian, and Hungarian food. You know, and there's probably a punchline there, but I don't have it.
Yeah,
Hungarian food.
A lot of sauerkraut and dumplings at my grandmother's house. But there's no. Nothing, you know.
It looks like Italy.
All I know is my father said, you know, he grew up next to the Polish neighborhood, and they would just make fun of they would do the Polak jokes. So okay. I don't think there's anything Czech.
There's such a difference in the DNA between.
Yeah. One end of a chromosome. Mm-hmm.
So was Gary going to do a song?
Gary who?
Good question.
Me. A song about
what is your ethnicity?
My English, Irish, French, and German. It's all white people. I have no melanin at all. I had to marry into it.
Wow, you married Pearl Bailey.
And is that a stopwatch at the end of your guitar?
Or am I just glad to see you? It's a tuner, actually.
Oh, a tuner. Okay.
Sing an A, Steve.
A.
No, it's not loud enough.
Half Japanese and half Chinese. Every December 7th, she attacks Pearl Buck.
Good Earth.
Only took me 10 minutes.
Wow. That's very good. Now I know what you were laughing about before. All right.
So, Gary.
Hi.
Hi.
All right, this is a song about collaboration, something you writers are only too aware of.
I have a friend.
Half Japanese. Wait a minute. I got half Japanese, half Northern Californian. Oh, nobody's going to get this. Every December 7th, he attacks John Steinbeck.
A Monterey, Grapes of Wrath.
He wrote the Pearl. Yeah, but
can anyone get us to Pearl Mesta? Is there a way? Just asking.
It's like the Kevin Bacon game.
My sister is half Japanese and half porn star. Every December 7th, she asks for a pearl necklace. Pearl, because that's from porn.
We're being rude to you.
No, you're not. All. This is. I'm laughing. I'm laughing like a monkey.
Okay.
My.
So, you were saying that
there was a setup.
Collaboration.
There was a setup. I began about 20 minutes ago. That about collaboration, something you writers are familiar with and have to endure. So, here it is. It goes something like this. I had my dreams and aspirations. I thought you'd back me all the way. Each time I tried to tell you all my best laid plans, you always had something to say. If it wasn't for you, I could be anything that I wanted to be. If it wasn't for you, every door would swing wide open just for me. I don't mean to blame you, but it seems so clear to me. It would all come true if it wasn't for you. Oh, yeah. You have a right to your opinion. No matter how wrong it might be. Sometimes I think that I should go it on my own. Then it would all depend on me. If it wasn't for you, I'd be autographing my biography. If it wasn't for you, I might even have my own show on TV. I could win Survivor. Oh, that is a show on Fox. I could be a celebrity if I could only learn to box. I
crystal clear to me. It would all come true if it wasn't for you. This is where the harmonica solo comes in. You bring the harmonica, guy. Well, I guess it could be wrong for me to blame it all on you. After all, it's only fair that I share the burden too. Without you here beside me, I wonder what I'd do. I'd be the king of the world with a golden statuette. I'd get all those women that I have not had yet. I'd be bigger than Dylan, Springsteen, and even old Elvis P. I'd be so goddamn big that the building would leave me. La 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 la.
Great. Thank you.
Can I just say something in all honesty?
Yes, you may. It's your show.
Okay. If you're part Easy. Italian and part Czechoslovakian.
Yes.
Instead of pasta primavera, they would cook pasta Prague spring. Because primavera. What does primavera mean?
Okay.
What does primavera mean?
Spring.
Green. So, something green.
So if it was, if you're part. By the way, that was beautiful.
You know what? I think you need to pause this for Gary, because obviously you were not listening to the song.
Primavera means spring. Hang on. Primavera means spring, right? And there was a Prague spring in 68, right?
I love explaining jokes.
But if you're in Czechoslovakia.
Yes.
So if you're Italian and Czechoslovakian.
And we're winding down.
A pasta Prague spring.
You know what? This is not even my show, and I'm going to fire you. And that's a wrap.
Gary Stockdale, that was beautiful. What's the name of your CD?
Oh, thank you. Shore of Myself, spelled M-I-C-E-E-L-F, just to confuse people.
Great. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.